Reddit users have been driving Wall Street crazy, investing in certain stocks like GameStop to force up the price. Several days of overheated trading activity prompted the investor app called Robinhood to suddenly restrict some trades, outraging retail, at home, by phone investors.
Understand people's anger, your customers' anger, given that essentially you changed the rules of the game right in the middle of the match, at the most important moment in the match. Even if your terms and conditions allow you to do that, do you understand their anger that you changed the terms of trade for them just as things were getting heated up?
I do, but when you say right in the middle of the game, then you're saying as the squeeze is going on stronger and stronger. But that's illegal.
The reason the market is doing what it's doing is people are sitting at home getting the checks from the government, okay? And this fair share is a bullshit concept. It's just a way of attacking wealthy people, and you know, I think it's inappropriate. We all got to work together and pull together.
They've been able to take these short sellers off guard, and they have to then race around and try to find the shares, of which there aren't many. This is an Apple, and that's driven the stock from $4 all the way up to $350.
The Redditors making money off of GameStop are taking advantage of normal stock market behavior called a short squeeze.
And that's when a lot of people on Wall Street short sell a stock, and what that means is that they've sold a stock that they don't own, betting that it's going to go down in price. But the problem is when it goes up, they have to buy those stocks, those shares that they don't have, to close out their position.
Despite being unusual, this is all completely legal.
A few moments later.
The larger problem, the idea that we've legalized gambling in the stock market and that stock options are something that probably never should have been legal.
Foreign investing app faces legal action today after it froze trading for several stocks that took a wild ride on Wall Street.
Other brokers this week have imposed restrictions, and not speaking for other firms, but for Robinhood in particular, this isn't because there's deals happening with market makers we route to or market participants.
But then why did you allow people to keep selling but not buying? The reason that is so troubling to people is that they were making money buying the stock because they were against the short side. And so by enabling them to sell but not buy, it sounds like you were allowing the hedge funds, and again, one of them owns a piece of you, and they had a big short position, and that looks like a stinky conflict that you didn't come out straight on from the start. Address that.
Well, I mean, they basically, the name of the company is Robinhood, steal from the rich, give to the poor, and they did the exact opposite. They stole from the poor and gave back to the rich. I unequivocally don't believe what he just said, Vlad. I think he's lying.
They spend billions of dollars every year lobbying to get what they want. Well, we know what they want. They want more for themselves and less for everybody else. But I'll tell you what they don't want. They don't want a population of citizens capable of critical thinking. They don't want well-informed, well-educated people capable of critical thinking. They're not interested in that. That doesn't help them. That's against their interest. That's right. You know something? They don't want people who are smart enough to sit around the kitchen table to figure out how badly they're getting fucked by a system that threw them overboard 30 fucking years ago. They don't want that. You know what they want? They want obedient workers. Obedient workers. People who are just smart enough to run the machines and do the paperwork and just dumb enough to passively accept all these increasingly shittier jobs with the lower pay, the longer hours, the reduced benefits, the end of overtime, and the vanishing pension that disappears the minute you go to collect it. And now they're coming for your Social Security money. They want your fucking retirement money. They want it back so they can give it to their criminal friends on Wall Street. And you know something? They'll get it. They'll get it all from you sooner or later because they own this fucking place. It's a big club, and you ain't in it. You and I are not in the big club. By the way, it's the same big club they use to beat you over the head with all day long, where they tell you what to believe. All day long, beating you over the head in their media, telling you what to believe, what to think, and what to buy. The table is tilted, folks. The game is rigged, and nobody seems to notice. Nobody seems to care. Good, honest, hardworking people, white collar, blue collar, doesn't matter what color shirt you have on. Good, honest, hardworking people continue. These are people of modest means. Continue to elect these rich cocksuckers who don't give a fuck about them. They don't give a fuck about you. They don't give a fuck about you. They don't care about you at all. At all. At all. You know? And nobody seems to notice, nobody seems to care. That's what the owners count on, the fact that Americans will probably remain willfully ignorant of the big red, white, and blue dick that's being jammed up their assholes every day. Because the owners of this country know the truth. It's called the American dream, because you have to be asleep to believe it.
Hey guys, don't forget to subscribe to my channel if you like the videos and you want to show some support.
The market volatility surrounding GameStop and other securities has highlighted how many people feel that the cards are stacked against them and that market participants, like our witnesses, hide the ball. Mr. Tenev, you explained that Robinhood restricted transactions in certain securities to meet demands coming from your clearinghouse. And yet, on January 28th, you represented to the media that there was no liquidity problem. Isn't it true that being concerned about having enough capital to meet deposit requirements, isn't that a liquidity problem? Or could you just answer yes or no?
Chairwoman Waters, I appreciate the opportunity to address that.
Just yes or no?
We always felt comfortable with our liquidity and the additional capital that Robinhood raised.
Please answer yes or no.
We always felt comfortable with our liquidity.
I don't have time. I just need a yes or no answer.
I stand by my statement. The additional capital we raised wasn't to meet capital requirements or deposit requirements.
The gentleman,
excuse me.
I'm reclaiming my time.
So as I was trying to explain, because the Robinhood order comes from a community of traders who tend to trade in smaller size.
That isn't my question, sir. You're evading my question by making up other questions. Let me repeat. Two identical orders come in. Same stock, same quantity. One's from Robinhood, one's from Fidelity. What happens?
The quality of the execution varies by the channel of the order. This is a commonly understood phenomenon in economics that channels matter. So for example, when you go get a mortgage from JP Morgan to their clientele has a different rate of interest than a mortgage.
Okay, let me, reclaiming my time, sir. Who gets the better deal? Well, one that comes from a broker who is being paid for order flow and one not. Can you testify that that on balance, there's no difference, assuming the same size of the order?
So as I said earlier, size of the order is only one factor.
You are doing a great job of wasting my time. If you're going to filibuster, you should run for the Senate.
I was going to start actually with this and ask each one of you why you thought you were here today. But I'm going to dispense with that because it's going to take too much time, and I'll provide the answer. Political theater, for the most part. That's what this hearing is today. I mean, we're on the business channels right now and on C-SPAN. I think if you see a few of my colleagues playing to the cameras. But we need to have some of these fundamental and important questions answered at the end of the day. And one of the assertions that you've heard already today is that investing is, quote, casino gambling. It's using monopoly funny money. I guess I want to know, is individual retail participation in the marketplace gambling, casino gambling, or using funny money? Mr. Gill, why don't we just start with you? Very quickly. I don't hear him. Mr. Huffman, let's move to you.
No, I believe that investing is investing.
Thank you, Mr. Mark. Has Melvin Capital ever engaged in short selling of the stock Tesla?
We have been short Tesla in the past. That's correct.
Mr. Bakken, also, this is a longer question. Did you see the tweet from Tesla CEO Elon Musk about GameStop stock?
I did see that after market hours on a Tuesday.
Do you believe that Mr. Musk's tweet had any significant effect of driving the rise in GameStop stock?
I don't want to speculate on what the actions of his tweet were. The stock did rise after hours.
This, then, do you believe that tweet was targeting you because you had shorted Tesla stock in the past?
We had a very small short position years ago in Tesla. That would be pure speculation as to his motives of putting that tweet out.
The stated mission of Robinhood is the democratization of finance, but I worry that the real world impact of Robinhood is the democratization of financial addiction. You know, Robinhood has gaming features that seem to manipulate retail traders into making rash and reckless and potentially ruinous investments. We all know the tragic story of Alexander Kearns. According to a memo from the Financial Services Committee, there's one feature in particular that encourages retail investors to tap on the Robinhood app up to 1,000 times a day in order to improve their position on the wait list for Robinhood's highly coveted cash management feature. Do you share my concern that a retail trader tapping on a Robinhood app 1,000 times a day is a sign of addiction?
Congressman, that particular feature that you're discussing was to get access to our debit card plus high yield savings product, which is one of the many, many features targeting passive investors that we've rolled out over the past
few years. 1,000 times a day? You are encouraging your customers to tap on an app 1,000 times a day? That to me is a sign of addiction, and it worries me that you fail to see it in the same light.
Congressman, we didn't encourage anyone to tap on anything. To get access to the debit card, people were placed on a wait list, and we wanted to give our customers delightful features so that they know that we're listening to them and that we care about them. And this is just one example of how we add great features that customers love to our products.
Look, addictive trading might be bad for your customers, but it's good for Robinhood. Addictive trading means more trading, and more trading means more money for Robinhood. There's a sense in which Robinhood monetizes addiction. You make money from the quantity rather than the quality of trading.
Earlier, one of my colleagues, Representative San Nicolas, said that Robinhood owes its customers a lot more than an apology. And I happen to agree with him. I believe that the decisions made by you and this company have harmed your customers. Mr. Tenev, would you be willing to commit today to voluntarily pass on the proceeds of the payment for order flow to Robinhood customers?
Congresswoman, I appreciate that question. When the statement you refer to was made, I believe 2015 or 2016, it was before Robinhood forced the entire industry to drop commissions and replicate our business model, which made payment
for order flow difficult. I should take that as a no. You're not willing to pass on the proceeds of payment for order flow to your customers?
When the other brokers dropped...
I'm just talking about today, right now.
Payment for order flow, Congresswoman, allows for commission-free trading. In the context of trading commissions, it's a much larger source of revenue in the past than payment.
Mr. Tenef, I apologize, and I don't want to be rude. I just have limited time. But if removing the revenues that you make from a payment for order flow would cause the removal of free commissions, doesn't that mean that trading on Robinhood isn't actually free to begin with? Because you're just hiding the cost in terms of potentially poor execution or the cost of lost rebates to your customers.
So certainly, Congresswoman, Robinhood is a for-profit business and needs to generate some revenue to pay for the costs of running this business. People were initially skeptical that the model, even with payment for order flow, would work when you remove commissions. And I think we've proven that otherwise by making this the standard model by which brokerages operate now.
I see.
I'm happy to discuss with the committee my purchases of GameStop shares and my discussions of their fair value on social media. It is true that my investment in that company multiplied in value many times. For that, I feel enormously fortunate. I also believe the current price of the shares demonstrates that I've been right about the company. A few things I am not. I am not a cat. I am not an institutional investor. Nor am I a hedge fund. I do not have clients, and I do not provide personalized investment advice for fees or commissions. I'm just an individual whose investment in GameStop and posts on social media were based upon my own research and analysis. I grew up in Brockton, Massachusetts. My family was not wealthy. My father was a truck driver and my mom a registered nurse. I was one of three kids and the first in my family to earn a four-year college degree when I graduated from Stonehill College in 2009. That was not a good time to be looking for a job. From 2010 to 2017, I worked at a few startup companies, but there were significant periods when I was unemployed. I took an interest in the stock market, and even though I had very little money, I used those times to educate myself and learn more about investing. In 2019, after nearly 2 years unemployed, I accepted a marketing and financial education job at MassMutual. My wife Caroline and I were thrilled that I had an income and benefits. My job was to help develop financial education classes that advisors could present to prospective clients. I was not a stockbroker or a financial advisor. I did not talk to clients and I did not recommend stocks for them to buy. Before and after I joined MassMutual, I studied and followed stocks. One of those was GameStop. In early June of 2019, the price of GameStop stock declined below what I thought was its fair value. I invested in GameStop in 2019 and 2020 because, as I studied the company, I became more and more confident in my analysis. Two important factors, based entirely on publicly available information, gave me confidence that GameStop was undervalued. First, the market was underestimating the prospects of GameStop's legacy business and overestimating the likelihood of bankruptcy. I grew up playing video games and shopping at GameStop, and I plan to continue shopping there. GameStop stores still provide real value to consumers and reliable revenue for GameStop. Second, I believe that GameStop has the potential to reinvent itself as the ultimate destination for gamers within the rapidly growing $200 billion gaming industry. GameStop has a unique opportunity to pivot toward a technology-driven business. By embracing the digital economy, GameStop may be able to find new revenue streams that vastly exceed the value of its business. I am hardly the only person who has advocated these points. When I wrote and spoke about GameStop on social media with other individual investors, our conversations were no different from people in a bar or in a golf course or at home talking or arguing about a stock. Hedge funds and other Wall Street firms have teams of analysts working together to compile research and analyze shares of companies. Individual investors do not have those resources. Social media platforms like Reddit, YouTube, and Twitter are leveling the playing field. The idea that I use social media to promote GameStop stock to unwitting investors and influence the market is preposterous.
My post did not cause the movement of billions of dollars into GameStop shares. It is tragic that some people lost money, and my heart goes out to them. But what happened in January just demonstrates again that investing in public securities is extremely risky. As I said earlier, I consider myself and my family fortunate with our investment. When the stock price broke $20 in December, I knew my investment was a success. I was so happy to visit my family in Brockton for the holidays. The money will go such a long way for us. We had an incredibly difficult 2020. Most difficult was the tragic and unexpected loss of my sister Sarah in June. I am grateful to be in a position to give back to and support my family. As for what happened in January, others will have to explain it. It's alarming how little we know about the inner workings of the market. And I am thankful that this committee is examining what happened. I also want to say that I support retail investors' right to invest in what they want, when they want. I support the right of individuals to send a message based on how they invest. As for me, I like the stock. I'm as bullish as I've ever been at a potential turnaround for GameStop, and I remain invested in the company. Thank you. Cheers, everyone.